Good evening, everybody, and welcome to our Shared Human Past webinar from the Department of Classics and Archaeology at the University of Nottingham. We're really pleased you've joined us this evening for our two talks on the moral of the story, the Argonauts and Aesop. So the purposes of this seminar series is to introduce you to some of the research interests and some of the fun stuff that we do within the department. And as part of that, when you've heard the talks, if you've got questions, please pop them in the chat. You can pop them in the chat as the talks are going on, and we'll get round to answering some of them towards the end. So my first speaker this evening is Professor Helen Lovatt, and I look forward to hearing what she has to say. Helen.
Hello everyone, I'm Helen Lovatt, and I'm talking about the Argonauts and children's literature and moral complexity. So morality is always something I've avoided, and that's because I think I consider it to be like both hotly contested and pretty much impossible to define. So it's just such a big category and one that is incredibly emotive. So can we move on to the next slide? The Argonauts is a really interesting myth for thinking about this. So I've been writing a book about the cultural history of the Argonaut myth from its beginnings right to the present day. And I've been looking at the different ways different cultures and periods and genres receive it and think about it. And one of the things that's very different in those different contexts is morality. And the figure of Medea in particular is very good for thinking about this and the way that she betrays her family. And I'm going to focus in particular on her killing of her brother, who's known as Apsyrtus or Absyrtus. So we've got a lot of different spellings of that coming up through. And I'm going to look at three particular versions in children's literature from the mid 19th century to the present day by Charles Kingsley, Xavier Perrotta, and Ken Catran. So could you next slide, please, Matt? Great, thank you very much. So for people who are not familiar with the Argonaut myth, I hope you've probably mostly watched the 1963 film Jason and the Argonauts with the amazing special effects of Ray Harryhausen. But if you haven't, I'll just give you a quick summary of what happens in the story. So Jason is the hero. He's the son of Isone, and Isone had his throne usurped by nasty uncle Pelias. Pelias, Jason challenges him, asks for his kingdom back, and Pelias sends him off to bring back the golden fleece from the faraway legendary land of Colchis, which turns out to be at the other side of the Black Sea, which is currently modern Georgia. And so the story tells of this amazing first journey of the Argo, Jason, with all the greatest heroes, including Hercules, helped by the gods, particularly the goddess Hera. And they go through the clashing rocks, and eventually, after many complicated adventures, they reach Colchis. And for some reason, King Aetes doesn't want to give them this incredibly valuable and important artifact. Jason is told that if he wants to have a chance of it, he has to tame the fire-breathing bull, sow the dragon's teeth, and defeat the warriors that grow from the ground, known as the Earthborns. So he's a bit upset about that, because how could he possibly do it? But luckily for him, Aetes' daughter Medea falls in love with him and helps him do that. And she has to betray her family in order to rescue Jason. And when they leave with the fleece, they are pursued, and the pursuit is led by her brother Absyrtus. Well, not always, but mostly. I'm going to come into the variations on this. And one way or another, Absyrtus gets killed. So could we move on to the next slide? So that's basically the sort of large scale version of the story. That the Argonaut tradition is incredibly varied all the way through, partly because the first complete telling of it that survives is from the late 3rd century BC, Apollonius of Rhodes. And we do have various fragmentary mentions of things that suggest there was almost certainly a very old epic tradition that was already well known to the poets of the Odyssey, to the Odyssey tradition. And there is a sort of tangential and complex play on the Argonaut tradition in Pindar's Pythian 4, and of course the very famous Euripides' Medea, and everything that comes later puts Jason in the shadow of Euripides' Medea. So those are some of the main versions from the Greek world. And as you come on through, there are lots of Roman variations. The late antique Orphic Argonautica is the main source for Kingsley's version, which we're going to be looking at. And there's also some really funky medieval material. So if anyone's interested in other bits, do ask later. Matt, can you move on to the next bit, please? Thank you very much. So one of the things that I've been looking at are where the points of variation tend to come up. And it's really interesting to me how they coincide quite often with moral dilemmas of one sort or another. And that's probably related to the fact that a lot of the variation is amplified and further complicated by the Greek tragic traditions. There are a lot of different tragedies based on episodes from the Argonaut story, including the terrible dilemma of Latimas, who thinks he has to sacrifice his children in order to stop his people starving. That's the Phrixus and Helle story. Whether the Lemnian women should kill their husbands or not, whether the Argonauts should sleep with them. Then the tyrant Amycus, who challenges the Argonauts to a boxing match, should they kill him or spare him? Then there's Phineas and the Harpies, and of course Medea's choices in Colchis. So all of these things are morally complex situations where people can make different choices, and that's where a lot of the variation seems to arise. Matt, do you want to move the next slide, please? Brilliant. So if you're not familiar with Euripides' Medea, she's been brought back to Greece at that point. It's after the end of the Argonaut story, and she has to decide how to deal with the fact that Jason is about to leave her, and then she takes her terrible vengeance on him. So it's very clearly an immoral act, but why she chooses to do it and how she could possibly get herself into that situation is part of the sort of the challenge and the excitement of Euripides' Medea and the subsequent receptions. Next slide, please. The death of Absyrtus is one of the most striking moments in the story, and this still from the 2000 film sort of emblematizes the moment. In this version, it's not in the 63 film because I think it's too problematic. In this version, he's rehabilitated, but he's a competing member of the court, sort of vying with Medea for influence. And instead of being murdered, he chases after them, tries to kill Jason from behind, but then gets killed himself. So it becomes a sort of accidental encounter. Next slide, please. So the book I've been writing is called In Search of the Argonauts, and it's looked at the history. It's due out with Bloomsbury in 2021. And I've really been going through and seeing the complexity and variety of the Argonaut tradition. So it's not just the reception of Apollonius, it's all these different variant traditions and how they're used in different ways. Next slide, please. So let's just give you a little flavour of a few of the versions. Kingsley is one of my favourites. So he was writing in the mid 19th century, and his book The Heroes is still in print. So it's a really influential part of children's literature. And he was a classicist, had already written about classical subjects, and was very irritated by Nathaniel Hawthorne's reception of the Argonaut myth. And it's a triptych with Perseus, Jason and Theseus all sort of summing up the nature of heroism. Next slide, please. He also illustrated the stories himself, and you can see a little bit about his sort of priorities and attitudes. So you've got, if you look at the School for Heroes image on the left, you've got Chiron and the probably baby Jason sitting on his back. And on the right, you've got Jason taking the fleece, a sort of very heroic, dramatic version of Jason, with Medea and Orpheus off at the side. Orpheus is very prominent because he really draws quite extensively on the Orphic Argonautica. Next slide, please. So what Kingsley does to reduce the moral complexity and make it acceptable for his audience. He does include quite a lot of moral complexity in comparison to Hawthorne, but he still has to figure out a way of sort of keeping it safe. And what he does is to make Medea the sort of scapegoat of everything that goes wrong for the Argonauts. So he calls her the false witch maid or the dark witch maiden. And she has a very close sort of erotic relationship with the snake, as you can see here. Next slide, please. So with Absyrtos, there are two main traditions that exist in the sort of wider variants. Either he's an adult who's leading the pursuit and Medea lures him to negotiate about whether or not she should be returned with the fleece, and Jason then murders him. That's what we have from Apollonius. And another equally early, possibly older version has him as a small child who she abducts and then brutally murders and scatters his limbs in order to delay pursuit. So those two versions are both pretty popular. Surprisingly, the second one, the much more brutal version, is much more popular in children's literature, which is quite interesting. Ovid plays around with it, which may be why. So Ovid's incredibly influential on receptions of children's literature. Next slide, please. So Kingsley's Medea, it's the second version. Then Medea, the dark witch maiden, laid a cruel and cunning plot. She killed Absyrtus, her young brother, and cast him into the sea and said, "Ere my father can take up his corpse and bury it, he must wait long and be left far behind." And all the heroes shuddered and looked at one another for shame. Yet they did not punish the dark witch woman because she had won for them the golden fleece. So it's all carefully separated from the Argonauts. They would have liked to stop her, but they're not able to. And at the same time, Kingsley sort of skips over it pretty fast compared to other versions. So he's clearly uneasy with it, but trying to sort of fence everything negative off on Medea, essentially. So that's Kingsley's way of dealing with it. Can we move to the next slide, please? He does talk about it clearly in a moral way. So there's a moral discourse about it, particularly when Hera tells them how angry Zeus is with them for violating hospitality and kinship. At that, some of the heroes cried, "Medea is the murderess. Let the witch woman bear her sin and die." So they clearly, the heroes themselves, want to get rid of them. And they seized Medea to hurl her into the sea and atone for the young boy's death. So great, we'll blame it on the woman and then take it out on her. But the magic bough spoke again. "Let her live till her crimes are full. Vengeance waits for her, slow and sure." So Kingsley likes to look ahead to the tragic tradition. He's quite interested in that. He doesn't ignore it or pretend it's not going to happen. But Jason could not love her after all her cruel deeds, so he was ungrateful to her and wronged her. So Jason is sort of exonerated from his betrayal. And she revenged herself on him, and a terrible revenge she took, too terrible to speak of here. So there's a limit to what Kingsley feels that he can say. Next slide, please. So I'm going to wave this. I didn't include the pictures at you, but this is Saviour Perrotta's version, which has an incredibly positive Medea. I thought it was a good counterpoint to the very dark Medea we have in Kingsley. So this was from 2000. It's aimed at really quite a young readership. So you can see it's got quite a small number of words and big, exciting pictures. It's illustrated by Jan Lewis. This is really fascinating because the story is wholly told from Medea's point of view. So it starts with an image of Medea, and in the faraway kingdom of Colchis lived a beautiful princess called Medea. She had magic powers. So we've got the idea of the princess, but she's given agency. And she's not demonized as a witch. Life was very dull on Colchis. Medea wished she lived somewhere more exciting. So it's this idea that she wants freedom and the ability to do fun things. Next slide, please. We do get the Colchian pursuit, but we don't get any killing of Absyrtus. So Absyrtus is just entirely left out, which is not that surprising. But what's interesting is that there is a pursuit. So Princess Medea's father sent his ships to recapture the Golden Fleece, but Medea whipped up a fog and hid the Argo. So he's come up with a completely different sort of magical way of doing it, and it puts her again at the centre. At last, the powerful princess was free, and there she is whipping up a fog and being the sort of emblematic figure at the end of the book. So that version's really interesting because it's for very young readers and it allows Medea to take centre stage. And the other version, next slide please, that I wanted to tell you about is, just wanted to point out that this is not entirely this sort of idea of Medea wanting to go free and being a sort of positive influence has a basis in ancient material. The version of Diodorus Siculus presents Aeetes and his wife Hecate as being involved in a tradition of sacrificing any strangers to Artemis Tauropolos. Next slide, please. And Medea as someone who, she's the daughter of Aeetes and Hecate, and she has the same powers as Hecate, but she does not like this this practice, and she likes to rescue the strangers. And as time grows on, she's more in opposition. So she's sort of taking on this sort of Greek role, this sort of liberated role. Next slide, please. And in this, she escapes and just happens to coincide with the arrival of the Argonauts. So it's nothing to do with falling in love with Jason. And she then makes a bargain to help him get the fleece in return for him taking her and looking after her. So that's a sense in which this idea of the story as being about Medea breaking free is not entirely unrelated to this particular ancient version. Whether or not that's a coincidence, who knows? Next slide, please. And the last version I'm going to introduce you to is by the young adult author Ken Cattran. It's called Voyage with Jason, and it's also from the year 2000. Cattran is a TV writer and a young adult novelist, and this was his first novel, which was quite successful. It won awards, and he's got a number of awards himself. And I was very interested to find that he cites the author Henry Treece as one of his favourites. And Henry Treece also wrote an adaptation of the Jason myth for adults called Jason from 1961. Next slide, please. I'm nearly there now. So Cattran's Absyrtus episode is very interesting. The whole story is told through a first person narrator who's a young boy called Pylos. In this version, Absyrtus and Medea are sort of vying with each other to succeed their very elderly father. And Absyrtus allies himself with the sort of nomadic horse people and then betrays as a coup. The father gets killed and Absyrtus and Medea are fighting. Medea then uses the Argonauts as a way to escape. And eventually she persuades Jason to lure Absyrtus and kill him. And she exercises power over Jason both by making Jason fall in love with her and by threatening suicide. So it's a sort of reversal where Jason is the person who's being driven by erotic desire as well as his desire to get the kingship in Iolcus. Next slide, please. So this is all about the cost of power, and Pylos ends up seeing what happens. So Jason makes him guard Medea to stop her killing herself, and he only gradually realizes what's been going on, and she sends him off to see what's happening, and he catches Jason just after the murder, sort of coming to terms with what he's done, and he has used the dagger Pylos gave him to kill Absyrtus. And there's a strong sense of this as a very problematic action, the host killing his guest, worst of crimes, worst, nothing pardoned that, and I was a witness to murder. Jason grinned, more an unpleasant stretch of his lips over his teeth, and Pylos, the life of a peasant is simple, but kings and princes do not lead simple lives. So we have this idea of it as the cost of power, that he, in order to achieve power and success, he has to commit murder. And we see Jason sort of gradually being corrupted across the course of the book losing any sort of sense of the hero worship that Pylos originally felt for him. So it's really very complex and thought-provoking portrayal. Next slide, please. So just to finish off, I hope I've brought out the way that morality is linked to mythical variation, that the points of moral dilemma are often the points where people feel the need to change it, whether or not they're following previous versions, and that different cultures rehabilitate things in different ways. So it's very notable that people are not pushing off the blame onto Medea in the way that they used to. It's interesting also how different creators are really drawn to the Argonaut myth because of its complexity, both its moral and textual complexity. People play around with that a lot. So Robert Graves, for instance, really likes to include all the different possible versions. And it's also really interesting to me how children's literature often doesn't simplify the moral dilemmas. Sometimes it does, but really there's a lot of moral complexity still there. For instance, Charles Kingsley is very similar in the way that he deals with it to William Morris, who's writing about the same time for an adult audience. The sort of refocusing onto Medea and exonerating her is very similar in Christa Wolfe's adult adaptation, Medea Voices. And Ken Cattran has really drawn very extensively on Henry Treece's adult novel. So a lot of different tactics can be used to create the same sort of effects, to make things acceptable. And there isn't as much difference as one might expect between the adult and the children's adaptations. So that's where I'm going to stop. Thank you very much for listening, and sorry if I went on too long.